Good morning. We'd like to welcome you this morning into our virtual worship service. I'd like to welcome anybody that's visiting with us for the first time. I say thank you, welcome. We just want to give honor to our pastor, our first lady. It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord today, Lord. So this morning, we just want to open up with scripture and prayer. The scripture will be coming from Proverbs 3, 1 through 6. And it reads, "My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For the length of days and a long life and peace shall add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them up about your neck, write them on the table of thy heart. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not to your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path." Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, saying thanks, Father. We thank you today, Lord, for the gift of life. We thank you, Lord, for just blessing our eyes this morning once again, Father, that we might just see the light of a new day, Father. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, Lord. We thank you for just being with us all week long, Father. So on this Sunday, Father, we come for no form or fashion. We come for but one only reason is to worship you, Lord, to lift up your holy name, Lord. So today, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for peace that you've blessed us with, Father. Father, I just want to pray today, Lord, for life, Lord, for family, Lord, for loved ones. Lord, it's tough living this life all by itself, but then it's tough when you live this life, Lord, and you got to watch loved ones fall away, Father. Father, so we just want to say thank you, Lord, for the time that you have given us in this place, Lord. We say thank you, Lord, for the time that you've given our loved ones in this place, Lord. And we continue to look to you, Father, knowing and understanding that we only have so much time in this place, Lord. So the time that we have is the time we need to take to worship you, lift you up, love those that don't love us, Lord. We need to become better Christians. We need to be who we say we are. Love one another. Love one another. We must show love, Father. So today, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I thank you for being my refuge. I thank you for keeping me, Lord. I thank you for walking with me, Lord. So, Lord, when I had to watch my loved ones fall away, Lord, I know it's going to be painful, and I know I'm going to hurt, but I have the understanding to know that it's going to be okay. But while it's going to be okay, I understand that I will hurt. But then I look to the hills. I look to the hills from where comes my strength, and I understand that there's a better place that I have to go, and they will go. So today, Lord, I said thank you. I thank you for keeping me. I thank you for strengthening me, Lord. I thank you for just walking with me side to side, Lord. So when I go through those rough days, when I go through those rough patches, I know you're with me, you walk with me all the way through, and you'll pull me out, Father. So I say thank you. So when we're hurt, we look to the hills. When we're in pain, we look to the hills. When we lose loved ones, we look to the hills. So I say thank you today, Father. Thank you for being who you are, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We serve a great God, a God that said he would never leave us nor forsake us. So today, we want to worship you today. We're going to worship you in spirit and in truth. So I say today, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah today, Lord. We love you today, Lord, and we thank you. So all these things we ask, Lord, in your son's precious name, Jesus Christ, Lord, we say thank you. Amen.
Ah! I'm thankful for all of you who have sustained your stewardship over the last 9 months. We give God praise for each and every one of you, and there are so many ways for you to be able to participate in giving here at BU. You're able to do it through snail mail. You're able to do it through our website, through our church app. You can go to Cash App. We are at Cash App at $UBC Allentown. You can use all of those mechanisms to give, but we want you to understand that your gifts are given unto the kingdom of God for the build of his kingdom, for the continuance and the furtherance of his kingdom. My prayer is that you will continue to flow in giving as we are giving throughout this community. We continue to bless this community. We want to remind you of the coat drive even now, that every Tuesday through Thursday from 10 to 3, you can bring gently used or new coats so that our coat drive might be successful in bringing warmth to some of our less fortunate individuals in this community. We thank you for all that you do. But we want to participate in our giving litany now as we prepare our hearts and minds for giving. We prepare our hearts and minds for giving. You cannot give if your heart is not prepared. Amen. And so let's pray. Father, we thank you for this privilege. We ask even now that you bless giver and gift. We ask that you would move on our behalf to engage us, Lord God, to a life of service, and that we understand that giving, Lord God, is fundamental to our Christian lives. We ask that you bless those that give, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold, may return unto them in the manner in which they have given it unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's engage our litany. We give because God has provided us his greatest gift in Christ Jesus. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes on him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. We first give ourselves to God as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service. We give our time and talent and treasures to support the ministry of this local assembly called Union Baptist Church. We give of our substance freely and of our own will without compulsion, but through our faith in the grace and the generosity of our great God. We bring our gifts each time we enter the house of worship because giving is an expression of worship to our great God. We give knowing that we are blessed to be a blessing to others. We give our best, believing that God will be pleased with our gifts. We give cheerfully and generously with anticipation and expectation that God will respond to our worship with his overwhelming grace. We thank God for this wonderful privilege to partner with the divine in kingdom building. The people of God said, amen. 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 Our praise team is going to come now, take us higher into worship.
Hallelujah. Just open up your heart and set the atmosphere. Hallelujah. Speak into the atmosphere.
Speak into the
Hallelujah, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We worship you this morning, Lord.
Yes, yes.
Give you all the glory.
Yes, Lord.
And all the praise. Fall in this place.
Yes,
hallelujah.
fresh wind of your spirit and visitation of your anointing. We ask even now that you have your way in this preach word. Move Haley out of the way. Lift up Jesus. Don't let people see me. Let them see you in me. Oh God, we pray that the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Lord, you are strength and our redeemer. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Everybody says amen. Hey God. A sweet spirit in this place.
Yes.
Refreshing spirit in this place. I don't care what you've been through, worship will change it. Care what you're dealing with, worship will challenge what you're dealing with the understanding that the God you serve is bigger than your issue. The God you serve is greater than your problem. The God you serve, God. Give you power in the midst of a pandemic. Hallelujah. What an awesome God we serve. Yeah, we just gonna bask in His presence for a minute.
Whoa!
How many of you know you're blessed this morning? Just to be alive, we're blessed. Just to be able to call on the name of the Lord, we are blessed. Hallelujah. If you have your Bibles this morning, I need you to turn with me to, once again, the first chapter of Ephesians. We are in our fall preaching series, and we'll be here until the Lord moves us, but we'll be from the book of Ephesians. I'm going to ask each of you to continue to read through the book of Ephesians, for it's contained in that book, the thematic thrust for our series. In chapter 1, I'm going to begin reading at verse number 8. It's not a sequence reading, but we're reading for the sake of the series, and so I'll be reading from verse 8 through 14. Don't know how many verses I'll get through today, but I thank God for His Word. The New King James Version of the Bible reads in verse 8, chapter 1 of the book of Ephesians, which He made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of His will, according to His good pleasure, which He purposed in Himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times He might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in Him. In Him also we have obtained an inheritance, glory to God, being predestined according to the purpose of Him who works all things according to the counsel of His will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of His glory. In Him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, praise of His glory. The people of God said amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated in the sanctuary just for a few minutes this morning. I want to talk about blessed, part two. Amen. Amen. We've been talking about the blessings of God and outlining the theological understanding of the nature of the plan of God, the mystery of the church. The book of Ephesians is powerful in that I believe that this book is the power book for the church, because in this treatise, Paul gives us three chapters that deal with doctrine, doctrinal truths, even though in the midst of giving those doctrinal truths, Paul is in the midst of a prayer. And in the midst of this prayer, Paul is really pouring out all of his life experiences with God. Paul has had magnanimous experiences with God. He has been educated in the things of God. He has been appointed as one who would work on one side of the aisle, if you will, as a Jew who was a persecutor of the church of Jesus Christ, only to have been made to have an encounter with the one he persecuted. At the conclusion of his persecution of Christ, his encounter with Christ, he became a missionary for the kingdom of God, as outlined in the precepts and the teachings of Jesus. Paul now is writing, some say from a jail cell, some say in the city of Ephesus itself, but Paul is writing with zeal and efficacy to make us understand all that he has gone through. And I believe that this is an amalgamation of all of Paul's writings, that he gives us this treatise for the understanding of the mystery of God, the mystery, the mystery, the mystery of God. And this theme of the mystery that has been in the process of being revealed even unto this day, this theme of the mysterion of God. I come to tell you, our spiritual growth and development as a church is directly related to our ability to understand and to be aware of what it is that God has desired to do in us relative to His overall purpose. Come here. It is important for us as a local assembly. I ain't talking to all of the rest of y'all. Thank God that you're a part of it. But really, it's going to reach you the same way Paul's letter reaches others who are outside of Ephesus. Because if I can put it aside in here real quickly, Paul really wasn't writing to the church at Ephesus. This was a circular letter that read to most of the churches that Paul had previously ministered to, which gives me indication that it does not matter what your denominational dictates are. It does not matter what the name of your church is. This book has a word that's for you. And so this morning, what I'm going to share with you, I don't care whether you're a member of the you or not, but just let me talk to the you real quick. If we are going to be a local assembly that is operating in the mode that God has designed for us, we have got to recognize that our spiritual growth and development is directly related to our ability to understand and be aware of what it is that God has desired to do in us that is relative to his overall purpose. Can I park and help you? That means that you, as an individual, have a part in the plan of God. God's overall purpose. Come here, I'm going to catch you on the backside. I said you with your low thinking self, you with your low self-esteem self, you who they told was never going to be anything, you who everybody said you could never accomplish anything. God says that if you are a blood-bought believer in the kingdom of God, in Jesus Christ, there is a definitive part in the plan, the overall plan of God and the purpose of God, and you have a part to play. You've got to gain an understanding, first of all, of what God's total purpose is. And then you have to recognize your purpose. Come here, I just said something to you. You've got to understand the overall purpose of God. And then you've got to understand your purpose. And when you become activated in exercising God's will in your individual life, you will then experience the understanding of what God is trying to do with you. Y'all didn't hear what I said. I hear so many people talking about God. I don't know what God's will is for my life. Understand what his will is in general, and God will show you where you fit into the mix. That's why the Bible tells you in James that what you've got to do in order to understand where you fit in the mix. James in 1:22 says that you must be doers of the word and not hearers only. Y'all missed it, come back and catch it. I said, if you're going to understand where you fit in the overall purpose of God, you've got to be a doer of the word. That means you can't just come to church on Sunday. Thank God for my deacons. Deacon Linda Robeson wrote this morning on Facebook that you cannot just understand church to be a Sunday morning experience, but you've got to be a sharing, telling, a show and tell it everywhere you go type of person. You got to show who you are, tell what he's done. Come on, show how he's been, tell how he's blessed you, show what he's brought you. Come on, somebody, tell how he's brought you out. Every day of your life, you've got to be a doer of the word. It's only when we are in the process of becoming what God has destined for us that we can really claim to be a participative part of the church, because here it is. The church is a participative organism. Come back and catch me. I said the church is a participative organism. It is not an organization that will allow or afford its members, its disciples, to be passive in your nature. Come here and help me. Let me help you. You cannot afford to be a part of the church of Jesus Christ and have a passive nature. Now, you, sir, you got an enemy who is not passive. He is aggressive. The Bible says that the enemy, the devil, goes about like a roaring lion. I ain't never seen a roaring lion that was passive. Come on, your enemy is aggressively trying to mess up your anointing. Your enemy is aggressively trying to derail your destiny. Your enemy is aggressively trying to mess up what God has placed inside of you. And so we can't afford to be passive as the body of Christ. But the reality is, if we were passive, the church would be dead. That's why Peter tells us in 1 Peter 2:3-5, he says, as newborn babes, you got a desire, God help me, the sincere milk of the word. Did y'all hear that? That you may grow thereby. If so be you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also, listen, as lively stones. Tell somebody, I'm a lively stone. I ain't no dead rock. I'm a lively stone. I'm going to do what God called me to do. As lively stones, you are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer sacrifice, spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. And my brothers and sisters, that is the description of a living, growing entity. And as members of the church, we are mandated to understand that we have got to take complete ownership, hear me, we've got to take complete ownership of our spiritual development by participating in the process of growth. You got to participate. Tell somebody, you got to participate. Got to participate, got to participate. Nobody can do it for you. Pastor can't pray you or preach you into spiritual development. Come on, teachers can't teach you into spiritual development. The prayer warriors can't pray you into spiritual development. It only happens when you become participative in the process of becoming that you're going to get to the level of maturity that God desires for you. So that means this morning we all have some work to do. We got some work to do. And so it's critical, Dex, that we have an awareness then of the plan of God so that we can become involved with God's plan. And Paul develops this theme for the plan of an ideal church in this book of Ephesians. I talked about it last week. He gave us some things that give us recognition of the blessing of God for the believers. He gives us these blessings. The one blessing that he gives us, Dex, is that we've been chosen by God. Thank God that we've been chosen. I know when I used to play basketball, Deke, I would be on the court and I was a little fella and everybody else was bigger than me, and I would be sitting there waiting for somebody to choose me. I would be anxious for somebody to choose me. And you know, if you ever got chosen when the big boys were playing, it was a special feeling when somebody chose you. You really didn't have any business being chosen, and really you don't know the reason why they chose you. It may not have been enough of the other fellas, but you just were glad that somebody chose you. I know somebody in here right now, you're saying, listen, I never played basketball, but I thank God in heaven that he chose me. God, help me here. I thank God that he didn't really have a reason to choose me. I didn't do anything of any significance for him to choose me. I really didn't have any prominence behind my name, but thanks be to God that he looked at me and chose me. He said, we're chosen of God, but then he said, we're accepted in the beloved. He has been accepted in a lot of places, but God has accepted you because you have accepted his son. We're chosen and we're accepted. But then he says that we've been adopted into the family of God. I just want to give you a review of what the blessings are in this book, in this chapter. He says we've been adopted into the family of God, not like a legal adoption here in the United States of America, but an ancient adoption whereby the family has made you real family. And God says that when you become a part of my family through your relationship with my son, I make you as my son. And I'm glad that I'm a child of the living God. He says that we've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Can I park and help you here real quick and give you an understanding of that phraseology? Because I really don't think we get it. I think that when we hear that we've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, automatically our mind goes to the fact that we've been bought back. But this really has nothing to do with the price that was paid, that was monetary. The reality of this situation is that we were redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and that simply means that God's particular power was great enough to get us back from the evil one. Y'all missed what I just said. Now, it is not by means of a price that a physical price that was paid in terms of money, but the reality is we were redeemed by the blood. In other words, God loved you so much that there was no price that could have been paid for your redemption. And so God himself, in the person of Jesus Christ, incarnate in the world, went to the cross and died for you. And it was an expression of his power. It's the power of God that delivers us. It ain't no money that's going to get you out of the stuff that you've been into. There's no price that can be paid to get you delivered from the things that you need deliverance from. But it is the very power, God, help me here, of God that has brought you out of where you were and placed you where you really ought to be. Somebody ought to say, thank God for for his power. I thank God for his power. He's able to deliver. As a matter of fact, we used to sing a song that said, from the utmost, Jesus saves. Yeah, he can pick you up and turn you around. Hallelujah. Jesus. Yeah, I said, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That's a lost word in America. Oh, I feel something coming with me today. That's a lost word in America today. We don't want to use the word of Jesus, but can I help the believers, the saints of God, the ones who are the disciples of God, who are trying to understand the plan of God? You're never going to exact the plan of God in America until we start using the name that is above every name. Yes, you can talk about all of our philosophical understandings. Yes, you can deal with all of our psychological machinations. You can deal with all of our sociological interactions. But the reality of the situation is, until we start invoking the name that is above every name, the name that at that name, every knee, God help me here, every demon in the hell's got to bow when you invoke the name of Jesus. Racism got to bow. Oppression got to bow. Crazy leadership got to bow. Sickness got to bow. Disease got to bow. Death got to bow. What? At the name of Jesus. Because at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. In things in heaven, in the earth, and under the earth. And every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ, I'm going to say his name until somebody gets it, that Jesus Christ, can y'all help me in your house? They won't let you say it on television. That Jesus Christ is the Lord of lords to the glory of God. And you need to understand, it's his power that brought you out of that crack house. It's his power that delivered you from that mess. It's his power that kept you from dying on that daggone bed you were on. It's his power. Power, the power of Christ. We've been redeemed, dear God, by the blood of the Lamb. But then we have the forgiveness of sins. Y'all do know. I know we got all these deep talk, these folk that really are trying to change the landscape of spirituality in this world and trying to make us believe that we are all psycho beings and we're not spiritual beings. I come to declare that we are definitely psycho-spiritual. No, we are spiro-psycho. Yeah, that's my own little thing. But we're spiritual beings living in an earthly world, dealing with our biological, sociological, and psychological issues. But we got to remember first and foremost that if Jesus paid it all and we receive his deliverance, we are spiritual beings. And the fact of the matter is that the Bible says, y'all don't like the Bible no more either, but the Bible says that the only reason Jesus came on earth was to forgive our sins. As a matter of fact, his whole name, Yeshua, means God saves. Y'all miss what I just said. And so the reality of our situation is we ought to get excited not when the Lord gives us a new house. We ought to get excited not when the Lord blesses us with a new car. We ought to get excited not when we get a promotion, but when you think about the fact that you could have been dead, sleeping in your grave, and not had a relationship with God, and it was because of Jesus who saved your soul. That's what gets me excited. Every day when I wake up, I say, I thank God for saving me. If it had not been for the Lord who was on all of our side, we don't know where we'd be. So he gives us the forgiveness of sins, and then he gives us this abundance of wisdom and knowledge. He uses that in us to make us see who we are, who he is, and how who he is affects who we are. God gives us this abundance of wisdom and prudence. And so I want to really, really mess with this morning, because the Apostle Paul starts in the early parts of his letter to the church of Ephesus, and he wants to engage them in some doctrinal teaching. He teaches them in the first three chapters of the letter, and it's necessary for the people to understand what their position in Christ is. That they understand what the walk of the believer ought to be. And then they ought to understand the impending warfare
prayer that every believer has got to encounter. Are y'all hearing me? There is a walk that you got to walk. There is an understanding that you're going to go through some stuff. But when you have a recognition of where you stand in God, when you know what your position is, you start to change how you encounter life. It's essential for every believer in God through Jesus Christ to gain knowledge of these truths in order to understand the purposes of God for this world and for those who are in relationship with their Creator. And can I just say it again, that one of the most major problems in this new millennium in the world at large, and specifically in the Church of Jesus Christ, one of the major problems is the misinterpretation of God, the misinterpretation of God's plan, and the misinterpretation of God's purpose for mankind. When you don't have any understanding of God's purpose or your own purpose for that matter, you live purposelessly. You live without purpose, with no consideration of the indwelled greatness that God has deposited in every believer. Did y'all hear what I said? When you don't know what God is doing, you don't know what you're doing, and so you do whatever you do, and whatever you do has nothing to do with what God is doing. I'm trying to help you this morning, but the reality is we live purposelessly because we have no understanding of what God has endowed us with, indwelled us with, and endued us with. There is a greatness inherent with your inheritance. When God fills you with his spirit because of your understanding of your relationship to him through Jesus Christ, you then take hold of the blessings in this text. And Paul says God has blessed us with abundant wisdom and prudence or insight through Jesus Christ. Listen, wisdom, my brothers and sisters, is the ability to see and to know truth. Wisdom is the ability to see and to know truth. Understanding, insight, or prudence, and all of these words are almost interchangeable, but the reality is that understanding, insight, and prudence is the ability to use wisdom in order to know what to do. God help me, come back, let me catch you. Wisdom is the ability to see and to know truth. Understanding, insight, or prudence is the ability to use wisdom to know what to do. And in these uncertain times, in these unusual times, and yes, in these evil times, wisdom, understanding, and prudence are essential elements of the people of God's lives. You got to have some kind of wisdom to navigate what we're going through right now. You got to understand this, though, in order to effectively express the wisdom, the prudence, and the understanding and the knowledge that God has given us, you have got to have a commitment to Christ and his cause. Come here. You can't just be a Sunday morning, turn on my YouTube, turn on my Facebook Live and watch some church and feel like I'm going to be able to live with power in this crazy world. No, you're going to find out that you're going to be running on fumes by Monday afternoon. But the reality is, when I'm committed to Christ, when I'm committed to his cause, I'm able to express the wisdom of God. I'm able to walk in the prudence of God, which means that I know what's happening, but I also know what to do. I need somebody in here that understands that when you walk with God, God will keep you in perfect peace, even when all hell is breaking off around you. Listen, the commitment to God leads to an effective prayer and devotional life. And our communion with God brings us the benefits of his presence and the blessing of his wisdom and his understanding. That's why Proverbs 4:7 says wisdom is the principal thing. But in all you're getting, you need to get understanding. That's why the Roman writer Paul again says in Romans 11:33 that, oh, God help me, the depth of his riches, of the riches both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Do y'all hear what he said? He said that the wisdom and knowledge of God is deep, y'all. You got to dig to get to it. You got to be committed to receive it. He said, oh, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. But then I heard Paul say to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 2:9, he said these words, as it is written, listen, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for them who love him. But God, listen, has revealed them to us. How? Through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of, y'all don't mind if I just get in the word for a minute, I am trying to preach. Y'all looking at me like, oh God, help me. No, this is what God is going to help you with. He said, what man knows the things of man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world. I think I'm going to stay there for a minute. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world. I got to say it one more time. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. Did y'all hear what Paul just said? Paul said, when you stop tripping about all this stuff that the world has presented to you, when you stop trying to run the rat race with everybody else in Pavlov's box, when you stop trying to keep up with the Joneses, when you stop trying to be like everybody else, and take your mind off of the things of the cosmos, and put your mind on the things that are in Kairos, let the Holy Ghost begin to change you. And the Bible says that you will know what God has freely given unto you. And I come to tell you that if you ever find out what God has really given unto you, there is really no weapon that shall come on somebody that's formed against you that will be able to prosper. When you start really understanding what God has freely given you, you'll be understanding of this text that Paul says, these things we speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things to spiritual. But here's the problem, Shanice. Here's the problem. Paul says in verse 14, the natural man does not receive the spirit, the things of the Spirit of God, for their foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one, for who has known the mind of the Lord but that he may instruct him? But we, everybody say we, those who are blood-bought believers, we have the mind of Christ. Can I just help y'all real quick and I'll get y'all out of here? The blessing of God to the believer is that we are granted the wisdom to understand ourselves to be spiritual beings who have transcended the natural world. I'm going to say it one more time. God has blessed you to be able to understand through his word and through the power of his spirit and through the wisdom that he grants you, the ability to recognize yourself as a spiritual being who has transcended the natural. Y'all messing, I guess y'all don't really understand what transcended mean. Transcended mean that I've stepped over and above all of the natural things that would hinder me from living my best life now. Can I just deal with you with that real quick? Transcended means that even though I see all of the things that are happening around me, I'm not going to become discombobulated by what I see, because my life is not hidden in the things of the world, but my life is hidden in Christ. And in Christ, I don't see what you see, because I don't walk by what I see, but I walk by faith and not by sight. And so any kind of circumstance and situation can befall my life, but I'm not going to lose heart, baby. I'm not going to be faint. I'm not going to fall back. I'm not going to be destitute. I'm not going to be depressed. I'm not going to be dismissive of life, because I know that's just a part of life, but it's natural life. And yet I'm walking through this natural life. Even though I got mountains on either side of me, I can walk through. Even though I can see the shadows of death around me, I'm going to keep walking through, because I don't worry about what I see. I'm going to walk through, because I've got grace. I've got goodness. I've got mercy. Come on, somebody. And so I know who I am. And when I know who I am, I'm able to transcend what I see. Come on, somebody. You need to learn right now. I don't know who I'm talking to, but you're sitting in your house and you're ready to take your own life, because things look real bad. Things seem to to be so terrible. But I come to tell you, when you know who you are in Christ Jesus, when you recognize the plan of God, and when you recognize God's purpose, God will start to show you your purpose. And anybody that I know is not going to take themselves out when they understand they've got something to live for. And for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And so I'm going to trust in the Lord with all of my heart. I'm not going to lean to my own understanding, but in all of my ways, I'm going to acknowledge God, and I'm going to watch God direct my path. Because here's the reality. We've had a year that's been a year of confusion for many people, but to those who have embraced and acknowledged the spiritual nature that God has presented to you, you had a year of revelation. Some of y'all know right now, you done seen some things this year that you never would have seen had it not been for a pandemic. You done found out some stuff about some of your friends that you would have never found out if the racial climate had not been like it is in this year. Tell somebody, thank God for the revelatory experience of 2020. Yeah, it looks like a bad year, but I thank God that no year that I'm alive and well is a bad year. It's a learning year. It's an understanding year. It's a revelatory year, but it sure ain't no bad year, because I'm still here. Tell your neighbor, I'm still here. Through all the trials, through all the tragedy, through all the tribulation, I'm still here. I got just a little bit more work to do. Here's the reality. And so in verses 9 through 11, you understand now that the mystery of God has been made known to the believer. Now, a biblical mystery is not some mysterious nether vault. No, it is something that has been hidden from man until God decides to reveal it. Paul says that the mystery that he talks about in this text is the mystery of the gospel. The good news concerning Jesus Christ, watch this, and the unifying nature of his death, burial, and resurrection. Y'all just missed the whole sermon. I said that the mystery of God is the mystery of the gospel. The euangelion Christos, the good news, thank God, about Jesus Christ. And this good news carries with it the unifying nature, God help me, of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And it is the truth that in Christ Jesus, everything can be brought into commonality and community. Okay, let me say it again. In Christ Jesus, everything and everyone can be brought into community and commonality. Okay, I gotta say it over here. In Christ Jesus, it don't matter if you're black or white, it don't matter if you're rich or poor, it don't matter if you're red state or blue state, it don't matter if you're libertarian or, well, come on somebody, it makes no difference who you are. When you are in Christ Jesus, the Bible says all become one. And that was the mystery of God from the very beginning, that God would bring everything in heaven and everything on earth into unity by, through, and in Christ Jesus. That's why you got to be careful about what gospel you listening to. That's why you got to be careful, because there's some in this contemporary era, who are looking to pervert this kind of gospel. They don't preach a unifying gospel of Jesus Christ, but they're preaching some strange fire, some strange gospel, a gospel that produces division, a gospel that denies the rights of other human beings who don't share their similar political views, a gospel that discounts rather than directs. And the blessing for the authentic believer is that God has blessed us with prudence and or insight into insight. Come here, y'all missed it. God has given us prudence, which is insight into insight. Prudence means how to use and do the truth. It means having a vision of a direction to take next. And when the world and its leaders are foundering in this self-aggrandizement, when people are frustrated and full of confusion about their future, the blessedness of being found in Christ Jesus is that God has graciously provided us with the wisdom and the knowledge and the prudence to not only but to be able to successfully navigate uncharted territory. And so let me just insert this edict to my brothers and sisters in the faith. The word of God declares to us that in the time of trouble, tragedy, and trials, we have this assurance in 1 John 5:20. And we know that the Son of God has come and given us understanding, that we may know him that is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. And then I heard the proverb writer say it like this, for God gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. And all I come to tell us this morning, and as we traverse the troubled landscape of this time, as we deal with the dilemmas and the diabolical disturbances that are designed and deviously planned to detour us from our destiny, as we deal with this pandemic season, and we walk through this unholy racial climate, I got to let you know that the mystery of God is found in his church, and the Lord wants us to understand that it's the church, the called out baptized body of believers in Jesus Christ. It's the church who've been blessed with the spiritual tools to change this world. I'm so glad that God didn't leave it in the hands of the politicians, because you see the mess they're making of it. I'm so glad that God didn't leave it in the hands of the businessmen, because they'd be all about themselves. But the Lord has given us this mystery called the church, who've been empowered, who've been chosen, who've been blessed, who've been given power, insight, wisdom, and prudence to know what's going to happen next. The government doesn't know what's going to happen next. The president don't even know what's going to happen in his body next. But I'm so glad that God has given the church, that's you and I, insight, wisdom, understanding. Can I tell y'all what's next? Fall down on your knees, push back from the table, and let God speak to your spirit. Because the reality is, what's next for you is not next for me. Because the old leg of the journey, I can't run. But God is so gracious that his spirit is poured out on all flesh. Talk to the Lord, he'll tell you what's next. Talk to the Lord, he'll show you your direction. Talk to the Lord. Look at somebody and say, pray, 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 pray in the morning, and pray in the new day, and pray in the evening, and pray in the midnight hour. The Bible says that men ought to always pray and not faint. I'm not going to get tired. I'm going to get on my knees. I'm not going to get tired. I'm going to get in my secret closet and say, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. Lord, help, I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, I don't have anywhere else to go. And so I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray until I see something happen. I'm going to pray, and I'm not going to get tired. Talk about me. Tell me that I'm just crazy. Tell me that I ought to do something. I'm doing it. I'm trusting God. I'm on my knees. I'm saying, God, if you don't make a way can't be made. God, if you don't help us, we can't be helped. But I know you didn't leave us, for your word declares you'll never leave us nor forsake us. So we gon' pray, we gon' pray until the government acts right. We gon' pray until there's a change in Washington. We gon' pray until white folk learn that they ain't better than black folk. We gon' pray until black folk understand we're not inferior to any folk. We gon' pray until God shows up. Is there anybody here that's gon' pray? Yes, I'm gonna pray. Yes, I trust him. Yes, I know him for myself. Anybody know that prayer works? Anybody know? We are spiritual beings. To the loose side of it. To let nobody theorize you into forgetting that you're part of the body of Christ. That's a spiritual entity. And when all of our carnal, worldly understandings and methodologies end, it is the mere opening of the door of opportunity for God. I know it looks hard out here. Y'all ain't never seen it like this before. But that's all right. You got something that everybody that's panicking doesn't have. You got a relationship with the one who made all this stuff for you. Y'all hearing me? You have, listen, you have a relationship. You go to him anytime you want to. And say, God, what's up? Y'all do remember that's how him and Adam talked. Adam walked through the garden. God said, what's up, Adam? Adam said, what's up, God? Until he decided to not commit to furthering his development in his relationship with God. And he chose his own path rather than the designed path for those who are the children of God. And whenever you do that, you put yourself in a position to not be able to be nurtured by the very presence of God. You're spiritual. You can't do what everybody else does. See, God showed you the mystery now. The expectation is that you're going to take that mystery to heart and that you're a part of the mystery. And this mystery needs revelation, which is why for 17 years on the wall of this church, that first banner says, Kingdom Ministry, watch this, revealing the will of God. Because God uses every part of his church to express the revelation of himself to a world that needs to know him. Because at the end of the day, he wants to unify everybody. Amen. Even the ones that you felt were outside of the sphere of redemption. Everybody through Christ Jesus. That's why you're ambassadors. You're going around the world to let people know you need Jesus. World thinks they need a whole lot of stuff. I'm gonna tell you right now, the world needs Jesus. Period. Where my young people at? Period. The world needs Jesus. You need Jesus today. You're watching, you're saying, Pastor, that's good stuff, man. That hoop was fine. I like that hoop. Forget that hoop. You need what I hooped about. I'm talking about a Savior who will catch you, watch this, right where you are. Not be concerned about who everybody else says you are. Not be concerned about the stuff you're doing, but he'll catch you right where you are. Come into your life, change your life, transform your life. Matter of fact, he'll give you a brand new life. And if that's you, and you're saying, Pastor, that's me, I need this Jesus in my life. Here's what I need you to do. If you're bold enough to say, I need Jesus, I know he's already there. He's already in your spirit. He's already convicting you. Just tell him, Lord, save me. I believe you died for me. I believe they buried you. I believe you rose on the third day with all power in your hands. I need you to transform my life. I'm ready now. I played with it for a long time. I'm ready now. I receive you unto myself. Let your spirit fill me. And I promise you, I'll live for you the rest of my days. If you said that, if you prayed that, I just believe in my spirit that you're saved. And we want to connect with you. We want to give you information. We want to let you know how great it is for you to be a part of the kingdom. We really would like you to be a part of our church. If not in our local assembly here, then you can be a part of our virtual campus. But we want you to know that we're appreciative of the fact that you've connected with the body of Christ. Just right down there in the text box, just put hashtag, I got saved today. If you pray that prayer, you believe it. Just hashtag, I got saved today. I guarantee in 24 hours, somebody will contact you. Going to let you know what it means to be a part of the body of Christ. Give you information about the Union Church, whether it be our virtual or our local campus. I'm just glad that you made the choice to follow Jesus. Listen, in about 30 minutes, we're going to be giving out registration forms. Those who want to come and be registered, meet us at the church here at 1 o'clock. Those who want to have help filling out your request for mail-in ballot, we have them here. We'll assist you in that endeavor. We want you to come. Make sure you get registered. We're only going to be here for an hour from 1 to 2. From 1 to 2. We thank God for you. Vote. Vote, vote, vote. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this time in your presence. Thank you for this word that you deposited. Thank you for Jesus Christ, the total submission to his ministry toward us. We pray even now for every person listening to the sound of my voice, that throughout this week, you'll bless them with power. You'll bless them with understanding, with prudence and wisdom. Protect them now. Keep them. Allow them to be the expression of your presence on earth. The revelatory nature of Christ might flow through you. Bless your people now as our prayer. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. And everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. In every nation, Zion, on these walls, to the right place of heaven, Zion, on these walls, to the high I'm gonna make you mine.